All right. Hello and welcome to another live sales chat. My name is John Golden from SalesPOP Online Sales Magazine and Pipeliner CRM. And I'm here in a lovely San Diego. Well, actually, it's not that lovely. It's raining, which is actually against the law for San Diego. But there you go. I'm delighted to be joined today by Alice Heiman, who is in Reno, Nevada. How are you doing, Alice?
I'm doing great. It's actually a bit cloudy here. It was supposed to be sunny. It was very nice yesterday. So yeah. I think a weather front is coming through the West Coast.
I think so. And our colleague is over all the way over in Europe, Martha Neumeister, who is in Vienna, Virginia. I used to live there. Vienna, oh my Austria. God. Vienna, Austria. How are you doing, Martha?
Hey. I'm fine, thanks.
Good. Alice Heiman is the founder and chief sales officer of the Alice Heiman company, and has worked in sales and sales performance improvement for many, many years. And today what we wanted to talk about was how to coach the complex sale. So if you are listening in or watching and you want to join in on Twitter, it's hashtag sales chats. So please, we encourage you to join in and join in the conversation and offer your own insights as we go along here. Okay, so Alice, how to coach the complex sale. First, maybe baseline it, because sometimes the idea or the phrase complex sale is thrown around. But what do you mean when you talk about complex sale?
Yes, I think that sometimes people use words differently, of course. Mm-hmm. And some people call an enterprise sale a complex sale. They use those interchangeably occasionally. Mm-hmm. But typically, a complex sale is one that has many components to it. It's going to have a longer sales cycle because there are more people involved, both on the buying side and the selling side. There are more complexities in terms of product and how the product is integrated or implemented. There may be large dollars at stake. And so people don't, you know, spend hundreds of thousands or millions of dollars lightly. And there, you know, are just other things that can make it complex. The competition, legal, you know, things that have to be done with contracts. So typically that's all those things make the sales cycle long, you know, 3-6 months, sometimes a year. And that is what is making the sale complex.
Yeah. And that obviously requires then a lot more planning, strategic planning, more people involved. So before the sales process even gets underway, right, there has to be a lot of strategic planning and even deal selection that goes into this, right?
Yeah. So I think one of the hardest things about this is that a lot of these complex deals are going down between small companies and really big companies, right? Mm-hmm. So there's only so many big companies, right? That's why there's the Fortune 500, mm-hmm. you know, the Fortune 1000. And then really most of the companies out there are smaller companies. Yes. And they all have great products and services and a lot of competition. And they want to sell these big ticket items to these really big companies. And so, you know, it really starts there with these companies that have an idea. Now, there's some very complex deals going on from big company to big company, sure. And medium to medium, small to small. But a lot of it is small companies selling to big companies. And that's another thing that makes it complex, because now there's more risk involved when you're mm-hmm. buying from a small company as well. But I think if we really want to do a great job with a complex sale, it really starts with targeting your audience. Because if you're selling to the wrong companies, mm-hmm. it's going to make the deal much harder, right? And if we're selling to companies who maybe aren't the best fit, it's going to make the deal harder. And the deal is already complex. So I think before we even get into how to do a strategy for a complex deal and how to coach it, we have to step back and say, what is the strategy for our company? Who are we going after? Are we going after the right audience? Because when we target our audience carefully and we go after the right ones, then the deal is going to be a bit easier. So that's an important place to start. Don't make it harder to start with, right? Let's mm-hmm. start a little bit easier. So I think that's where we want to look to.
Yeah, and that's a challenge, obviously, for especially you're talking about small companies selling to big companies, because obviously when you get an opportunity to sell to a big company, everybody gets excited and all of that, and you tend to maybe pile a lot of resources in. And as you say, if it's not the right target, I mean, that can be potentially catastrophic to the small company to chase a deal that they don't have a really good chance
of winning. They waste a lot of time and resources only to find out in the end that it really isn't a good fit and they shouldn't close a deal, or they close the deal and it becomes a nightmare on the implementation end.
Yeah. So how do you coach when you work with companies? How do you coach them in deal selection and how to really qualify an opportunity properly and make sure they go after the right ones?
Well, the first thing is I coach the sales leaders to help their salespeople understand that when you're going after a complex deal, you don't start talking to people until you've done your homework. Mm-hmm. So this is a huge problem, right? Because one, we don't know enough about the company we're selling to, their industry, their products and services, their goals, and their customers. We simply don't know enough to have an intelligent conversation. So all we can do is pitch, right? All mm-hmm. we can do is demo and pitch and tell about us, when that is certainly not going to move the sale forward in most cases. So it has to start by coaching the salespeople. Here's your target list. Let's do the research first. Mm-hmm. Let's get all of the right information. Now, it's interesting because, you know, most companies are getting leads by either buying a list or doing their own research online or going to trade shows. Mm-hmm. Which reminds me to tell you that I'm also the co-founder and CRO for Trade Show Makeover, which is a new company that I just started that has to do with the complex sale as well. And that's because many of these companies start their journey with a customer at a trade show. And so because I met you at the trade show, I think I've got an interested party that I'm going to do a deal with.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
I need to go back to my target list. Are you a good fit? You know, do you fit my ideal customer profile? Great that I talked to you at this conference, but that doesn't mean you're a good fit, right? But even if you are, I have to stop. I got to pause now. Of course, I'm going to reach out to the person and continue the conversation, but really quickly, I have to pause before I talk to anybody else and do my research. Find out who all the other buying influences are. Find out about the company, about what their goals are, what they're doing, what they're selling, who my competition might be, who their competition is, who's their customer, before I get back on that phone with the person who I met at that conference who's interested. Because that call may be, hey, doesn't look like it's a good fit, but it was nice to meet. And, you know, let's see if there's something for the future. Or it might be, hey, looks like this is a great fit. Here's what we need to do next. We need to get all of these people involved, and this is what it would look like to move it forward. But we don't. We just rush in. We get that one person. Then we get stuck with that one person. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we are wondering why we can't move these deals forward.
Yeah. But we have a really nice relationship with that one person, right?
Exactly.
And probably take them to lunch a few or 5, 10, 15 times. So that's an interesting point that you raised there. And I think this is a trap, as you said, that a lot of people fall into, is that idea of you make contact with one person and then you build them up in your mind that this is the right person, and they may be great to talk to and they may say all the right things. But to your point, in a complex sale, you have to understand the ecosystem of the customer. So you have to do your work behind to see who actually has the decision making authority, who has the need, who may be a potential obstacle, like all of those things.
Just an old-fashioned org chart is helpful sometimes, you know, and especially with a really big company, because if the people you're talking to aren't anywhere on that org chart, you know, they're way below, you know, you've got to think about where is the money coming from? It's going to come from somewhere, and it's probably not this person. Not that you're ever going to get up to that CEO level of a Fortune 500 company, or even the CMO or the VP of sales, but you need to know they're there, be aware of them, and talk as if you know them and know that they're part of the decision, even though you're not going to get to talk to them. But we oftentimes get stuck, even though we know it's not the right person, but we don't want to make them mad. You know, salespeople, unfortunately, want to be liked and good salespeople are not as much about being liked as about being knowledgeable, being helpful, being able to navigate, and really being able to present to the customer that if we're going to solve this problem, here's how it's going to work. Right? So I can help you solve your problem and it looks like this. And in order to do that, we're going to have to get all these people involved. If the person that you're talking to doesn't want to get anybody else involved, you're not going to go anywhere anyway. So what's the point? Why continue? So you may as well talk with them about the need to talk with other people and how to investigate the problem more thoroughly and how to come to a conclusion about whether it's a good fit. And go on that customer journey with them versus just try to keep talking to that same person who has no authority and doesn't even know how to sell inside their own company to help you.
Yeah, but and that's a and then another great point, and that's why actually on the pipeliner side that we built in both org charts and buying centers, because here's something that you've probably come across more and more. As you say, you can have an org chart, but you can have people with outsized influence who maybe don't sit that high on the org chart. They just happen to influence this particular project, or you have consultants or somebody else influencing. So the idea of a sales manager working with their salesperson to really sit down and try and pinpoint all the different people who could possibly influence the sale, including, as we say, there may be an obstacle, there may be an naysayer in there.
Yeah, absolutely. So I think once, you know, the first thing the coach has to do, the sales manager has to do as a coach, is help the sales rep determine, is this a good fit? Is this a real opportunity or not, right? So what can we do to figure out if it's a real opportunity? Well, we start asking some questions, right? Mm-hmm. And I think that's the best tool a coach has, are the good questions that they ask. So the salesperson can either answer them or they can't. If they can't, they need to go back and get the answer. So if I have a sales opportunity, obviously I have to know who's involved in making the decision. I have to know what the budget is. I have to know why it's a good fit and what they might do instead. I have to know how long it's going to take and what the steps are to get there. And I have to understand, you know, what people's feelings are about this solution or any other solution and how it's going to impact their career, their life, their, you know, everything they do every day. So as I ask the salesperson those questions, well, who else is involved? If they can't tell me, that's the first clue. Well, the first thing we have to do is decide who's going to be involved in making the decision. Secondly, how are they going to decide? Right? Then what's the timeline for the decision? So these kinds of questions have to be asked. And if the salesperson can't answer them, then they need to go back and get that information. And if they can't, then it's probably not an opportunity. They're still prospecting. They're not actually going to put that in their pipeline yet. And so those tools that you have, you know, inside your CRM can help them see clearly, I don't know enough people, I don't have enough information. So visually, they can also see. And I think that's important as well. So drawing any kind of map that shows you how you're positioned to make a sale is super important.
Yeah. And I think you raise another really excellent point again about the explicit questions, because one of the things I wrote something a while back, a few years ago, about happy ears, having the happy ear syndrome. And sometimes we interpret the things we hear, right? I could have a conversation with you, Alice, and you never say that you have budget, but I go back and my sales manager says, well, do they have budget? And I go, oh yeah, they'll have budget for this, because I have put together a few things that you said, and in my head, I've come up with, yeah, she's gonna have budget. But if it's explicit, like you said, and I think that's a great thing with sales managers, is to get the salesperson to get these questions answered explicitly, not by opinion, but explicitly, right?
Yeah, I think the other thing too is that the sales leader who's doing the coaching has to understand what their role is. So you're coaching them, you're asking them these questions, you're sending them back for more information, but you're also needing to find out what other resources they're going to need. So let's say it is a real opportunity, but of course more questions need to be asked, more people need to be brought in. Well, again, part of the complexity is not just the seller side, but the not just the buyer side, but the seller side too. So who from your team needs to get involved and at what point? I think that we are waiting too long to get others from our own team involved in the sale. And that's lengthening our own sales cycle. These days of the, Lone Ranger type of salesperson, individual contributor are gone. You know, the companies who buy from you just aren't going to tolerate that. They need to know who your team is. They need to know that there's power behind that salesperson. And so I think the sales leader has to be asking the questions again, you know, okay, now you know who all the people are involved. What resources should we bring in? Do you need me on the call? Do you need a subject matter expert? Do we need to bring our CEO in if their CEO is going to be on the call or somebody higher level at their company, and start to get the resources pooled? Maybe there's some separate conversations that have to go on about integrations or implementations or things like that, compatibilities. So I think we're waiting too long. It's like at the beginning, if the salesperson does a good job of figuring out who's involved and how they're going to buy, then they can help match the resources needed to the buyer's journey and make it move faster.
Yeah, I love that point as well. From two perspectives. One is, if you do look at all the resources that you're going to need to bring this home, it gives you a good indication of whether, again, whether this is a piece of business you want. Because let's face it, you could end up looking at it and going, by the time we've invested all these resources, we're going to lose money on this deal, right? But if that's not the case, the other part which I really like is introducing the customer to the fact that you have these resources ready to work with them. Because as you mentioned earlier, if you're a small company selling to a big company, one of the objections that's going to be in the mind of the big company is this company going to be able to deliver?
Right. Absolutely. Are they going to be able to deliver? So I think, you know, it's interesting if you follow Gartner, they have a lot of great information on the customer journey. And there's one slide, and if you just Google the long, hard slog, Brent Adams, and I've heard him talk twice about this now, about how this customer journey is a spaghetti bowl. Mm-hmm. And it's just really complicated and mixed up. And the people inside the organization, the buyer organization, really don't necessarily know how it's going to go down either. And it's changing all the time. So they have a lot of things that they need to do. So all of these people who have to come to consensus in the end, you know, they have to validate, they have to look at other sources, they have to look at, really examine the solution. They have all this work they need to do, and they don't all do it in tandem. Mm-hmm. So as salespeople, if and as sales organizations, if we understand what it's going to take for the buyer to buy, and we can help lay that out for them, well, organizations similar to yours, when we have brought in this solution, we know that they've had to bring in IT, and they've had to bring in you know, the accounting department, they've had to bring in these other resources. And, you know, so these are the people we know that need to get involved. We also know that not only are they going to need to pay for our product, but there's going to be some training and, you know, there's these other things. So we're going to try to help them understand all the pieces to help them on that buyer journey versus, you know, just letting them go on about it themselves and us not really knowing what's happening.
Yeah, and I think that's another great point that you raised there, because of sometimes it's easy to make the assumption that the buyer knows their own process or knows how it's going to play out. And what you're saying is, no, that's not always the case. But the other thing I think that sometimes we don't do enough of is we don't do enough of bringing the experiences that we've had with like customers. For me, if I'm in a buying situation, that's one of the most valuable things that a salesperson could talk to me about, is give me some insight that I could never get myself into how they had worked with like customers. And I think to your point, laying out the process of how this is going to unfold is very reassuring to a buyer.
Absolutely. And especially to a team of buyers, right? Mm-hmm. So they see that you have a plan, that you understand them, you understand their buying process, you understand how difficult it is. Buyers are getting fatigued. They want something, they find it, they do all the research, and then they can't get their company to move, right? Mm-hmm. And so then they have to do their regular job as well as try to help the salesperson sell this product to their company. It's not easy. And so they definitely get fatigued. And we have to know that and understand that. And again, be there. How can I make it easier? How can I help you? It's because I'm going to stay on top of it. I know what's happening. I know what you need to do next. I know what these other people need to do on my side, on your side. And we move through this journey together. Now, if salespeople want to start telling me, oh, well, they don't want our help, they don't want this, and they don't want that, then they're not serious and they're not going to buy from you. because anybody who's buying something that is complex is going to need your help, and they want you to be an expert, not just a seller. So if your sale is not complex, perhaps you're right. Perhaps they can just go look at a few things on their own, come back, make a decision, and give you a check or pay online. But in the complex sale, it just doesn't work like that. So if they're telling you, oh, yeah, you know you're in trouble.
Yeah, it's funny you mention that, because we actually did this ourselves recently, just based on our interactions with customers, is that, you know, we laid out a website that tells you what is required from your resources, what is the overhead in terms of time and commitment, what they need to do, because we were getting that question a lot. And I think it's something that is not always intuitive on the seller side, that to lay out an easy plan for all the resources and the commitment on the side of the buyer. And once you lay that out, then the buyer at least can prepare for that, right? And say, okay, now I understand what's needed and I understand the roadmap ahead. I can work on my side.
I think it's really nice to have a roadmap and a visual one as well for your buyer. And I think our websites, if I might be so bold as to say, most of our websites really suck. I mean, they're really terrible. It's really hard to figure out what you sell and how you sell it and how much it's going to cost and what it's going to, it's just really hard. Now, of course, when things cost hundreds of thousands or millions of dollars, you can't put that on your sales, you know, every scenario on your website. But what you can do is say, this is what we sell. You know, this is how it helps you. This is how you get it, right? Make it really clear. And like, here's a map. You do this and then you do this and then you do this and we're going to help you. We're going to, you know, we're going to get you what you want. But I think if we all took a really good look at our website from a customer's point of view, it'd be pretty sad to try to, you know, figure out, you know, nothing about it. And you're sitting there looking at it, trying to figure out what these people sell. So I think any kind of visuals are fantastic. I mean, it's one of the things I love about my former companies, Miller Heiman, Miller Heiman Group now, and they have a way to map the sale visually for the salesperson. And a lot of smart salespeople take this strategic analysis and bring it right to the customer and say, I'm mapping this journey, you know, let's map it together so we can get this deal closed. Let's get you what you need. Let's solve your problem. You know, here's how it works. Here's a map. Let's go. But I think people are just kind of fear-based. They're worried that the person won't like them. They'll make a mistake. They'll slip up. But if you do your homework and you're matter of fact about it, and you know, you say, this is how it works. Tell us how it works on your side. Let's put it together. And you ask the right questions. You can make it happen. I think a lot of times it's just a lack of confidence. So again, back to the coaching, the coach has to help the salesperson have what they need, make sure they do their homework so they don't end up looking like an idiot, make sure they can bring in insights, you know, make sure they have the tools that they need, a map, a good website, you know, other great programs to use that will help them, like yours, you know, just things that will enable the salesperson to actually help their customer.
So as you get further down the sales process, so you've got the initial good selection, you get into the process, how does the role of the coach change? Because one of the things that we see with a lot of sales managers, a mistake that's made is instead of being in that coaching role, as it gets further forward, they start to nudge the salesperson aside and they start to take over as the super closer. So what should the role of the sales leader, the coach, be as the deal progresses?
I love that. The super closer. I'm going to save the day. And I just see far too many times that is absolutely the case in small companies and in large companies. If you have been doing the right kind of coaching all along, you're playing your role, which is asking hard questions of the salesperson to make sure they're getting the answers, assembling the team and the resources that are needed. And so as we move down the pipeline, things should be going smoothly because your role is to continue to ask those hard questions and to continue to show up at the meetings that you need to show up and provide the resources. So in my mind, always, closing should be a natural next step. It should never be this big event. Oh my God, we've got to close the deal. Because if it is, you've done it wrong, right? You're moving together on the buyer journey. You're going with them, you're assisting them, you're helping them. And so you know what's going on and you know if there's an objection, you know if there's going to be a problem because you've got a coach you've developed over time and maybe two or three, and you're continually confirming and asking questions and knowing that things are going the way you want them to. So at the close, it should be very simple because we've all agreed and now it's the date that we've agreed to. I think a big mistake that we make is we don't ask enough questions about timing. Not when are you going to sign the contract?
Sure.
When do you need this to be implemented, right? Mm-hmm. And so if it needs to be implemented on this date, what's the date you're going to make your decision by? Because then what between the implementation and the decision is the closing. Mm-hmm. And it's very simple. So it's not guessing when is the closing date and guessing because it's your quota that you're going to close it, because you know, customers control your close date, not quotas, right?
Exactly.
So if we ask enough questions about timing all along the way, is this timing still going to work? Are there other projects getting in the way? Are there other priorities that are going to take you away from this? If that's the case, then we have to readjust the timing and the close date. So if we ask the right timing questions, again, the coach is like, well, when are they going to close? That's the wrong question, sales manager. When are we going to close is the wrong question. When do they need it implemented by? When are they going to make a decision by? Then we know the date in between, somewhere in between there has got to be the close date and we can nail it down. Well, if you'd like it implemented by this date and you're deciding on this date, that's either possible or impossible. And I can tell you which one it is when I know those two things.
And so before we run out of time, I do want to ask you another question about just coaching in general, right? A lot of organizations do not equip their sales managers or sales leaders to be coaches, right? And coaching isn't something that really comes naturally to most people. It's a skill that has to be learned. So I know there's a lot of work that you do with organizations. What difference have you seen between teaching somebody how to be a really good coach and not? I mean, what are the differences that it makes on a sales organization?
Well, it's a huge difference. When sales managers stop managing or really micromanaging, they're asking the wrong questions and all their focus in most cases is on what's going to close right now instead of looking further out and making sure things are moving. And so they have their focus on the wrong thing and they're asking the wrong questions in the most cases. And it's because they have tremendous pressure on them. And it's also because they haven't been trained to do anything else. So the sales leaders need to know how to have great one-to-one meetings. They need to know how to have a great pipeline review. They need to know how to coach a deal to move it forward. They need to know how to help set strategies. And these are not necessarily things that they're taught. They might have learned them somehow along the way. The coaching is about asking good questions. So we've got to teach them that. And it makes a huge difference. Deals close faster. We help our salespeople advance more quickly and become better. We also can figure out more quickly who needs to go. You know, so if we're doing proper coaching, we don't keep the salespeople who aren't making it around very long. We let go of them much more quickly because we see clearly and they see clearly that they're not going to make it. And then we can focus our attention on the people who can really do a great job. So we absolutely have to spend the time and money needed to teach our sales leaders how to be great coaches, and not just the managers of the salespeople. The managers of the sales managers need to learn how to coach also and how to set these strategies and help the whole team move forward.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. And it's my personal belief that your greatest revenue multiplier in your organization is your sales management and your sales leadership, because if they're operating at the optimal level, they'll get the teams to perform at the optimal level. And I think, you know, investing the time and energy into making them the best coaches. And this is something, AliceHeiman.com, if you want to learn more about some of the things that you do there. But before we go, we always like to ask our guests on Sales Chat is, what's your power tip, right? So what do you do every day to set you personally up for success?
Oh my gosh. I think the most important thing that I do is just keep a positive attitude. So when the negative thoughts start creeping into my head, I immediately flip them. So, you know, if somehow I think, oh, this is going to be a tough day because I've got so many sales calls in a row or so many people that I have to coach today, I think, oh, it's going to be a tough day. I immediately go, this is going to be a great day. I'm going to have some challenges that I will be able to manage because I'm really good at this. So I really try to flip my script. Negative thoughts creep in all the time, but I don't let them linger. As soon as they come, I try to get a hold of them and get rid of them and replace them with a positive one.
Yeah, that's fantastic. Because did you know, because I saw this stat from Psychology Today or something, that 68% of our self-talk on a daily basis is negative. So what you're talking about there is flipping that. And then I love the fact is like reaffirming with yourself going, I'm good at what I do. Because I don't think we do that enough sometimes. I think sometimes we second guess ourselves too much. So I really like that power tip. So before we go, Alice, do you want to just tell everybody a little bit more about yourself, your organization, how they can learn more about you?
Yeah, so go to aliceheiman.com, and especially if you want more information on the complex sale, please read some of the blogs. Just, you know, search bar complex sale. There's lots of great things on that. I have some bright talks on the complex sale. You can look those up as well. And please take a look at my new startup, tradeshowmakeover.com, which is about how you're going to generate leads for the complex sale through trade shows and events.
Yeah, I'm going to check that out. That's amazing. Thank you. Best of luck with that. I think that's a great, great, that's a great endeavor, because let's face it, we've all been to many, many trade shows over the years, and we probably can count on one hand how many times they've turned into big opportunities. All right. Well, listen, my name is John Golden, SalesPOP Online Sales Magazine, Pipeliner CRM. My colleague in Vienna, Austria, Martha, good activity on the Twitter chat today.
Yeah, we had very good insights. No questions, but very good insights. And yeah, it was great.
Excellent. And Alice Heiman in Reno, Nevada, thank you very much. And again, check out aliceheiman.com, and see you all again for another sales chat really soon. Thank you.